good morning and welcome to everyone. I'm very pleased to have you here. We're launching this new series of policy lectures on the effect, mostly on the effect of trade on labor markets. DDGE will start with a short few words of introduction, and then we'll continue with the two presentations and a questions and answer session. DDGE, you have the floor.
Thank you, Mark. Good morning, ladies and gentlemen. It's my great pleasure to be here with you today to inaugurate our new policy lecture series. This series is part of the WTO's Trade Dialogue initiative, which was launched earlier this year to provide all WTO stakeholders with the possibility to discuss their views on trade-related matters. To that effect, leading technical experts will be invited to share their insights on timely economic topics with representatives of WTO member governments and the wider Geneva trade policy community. This will give us all the opportunity to deepen our understanding of these important topics. The first three lectures of this series will address the labor market effects of trade and technology. Among rhetoric against trade has gained momentum in a number of economies, and the impact of globalization on wages and jobs is mentioned frequently in this context. There is a sense among the broader public that trade experts, economists, and politicians have tended to minimize distributional concerns and often put too much emphasis on the gains from trade and too little on the cost of adjustment. Well, there is ample evidence that overall trade generates benefits. It is also clear that these benefits come with adjustments that can involve costly transitions of workers between firms, sectors, and regions. And many economists have argued for many years that these adjustments need policy attention. However, as much as trade may be contributing to adjustments with sometimes important repercussions for workers, it is only one of the factors contributing to such adjustments, and in all likelihood, a relatively minor one. Indeed, technological progress is definitely another crucial driver of economic change that brings about welfare improvement, as well as cost of adjustments. Therefore, when considering the effects of trade, it is necessary to keep a broader perspective and to analyze these effects in relation to those of alternative determinants of adjustment. With the policy lectures, the aim of the WTO is to help balance the debate on trade with a view to make sure that the right solutions are applied to the problems that have been raised. Globalization and technological progress reinforce each other in promoting sustained economic growth and improving living standards. In the process, the nature of economic activity and economic relations undergo transformation. A clear understanding of how such changes affect labor markets is crucial for designing economic policies that facilitate the adjustment and spread the benefits of trade and technology as widely as possible. It also ensures that policies which promote trade, technological progress, and ultimately growth and development benefit from broad public support. Today's lecture will focus on policies that can help with adjustment to economic change. The speakers will discuss the experience with such policies, focusing on two specific approaches. The first is a targeted trade adjustment fund that was put in place by the European Union. The second is a general labor market policy approach known as Flexicurity, implemented by Denmark. The next two lectures will respectively address the linkages between trade, technology, and the labor market, and the effect of trade on the relative wages of skilled and unskilled workers. On December 12th, Professor David Dorn from the University of Zurich, one of the leading experts in this area, will present some of the main findings of the recent research on the effects of trade and the technology on labor market outcomes. And on December 20th, Professor Eric Verhoeven from Columbia University will focus on the linkages between trade, wages, and inequality. Let me conclude by expressing my belief that by promoting an informed and transparent discussion, this lecture series will help counter excessive claims about adverse impact of trade and trade agreements on employment and support the case for an inclusive world economy. I thank you.
Thank you, DDGE. I first want to warmly thank our distinguished speakers for having accepted our invitation to come and to present to you two interesting examples of adjustment policies. Before I give them the floor, I would just like to introduce them briefly and to say a few words about the organization of today's lecture. Our first speaker today will be Lucian Cernat. Many of you probably know him, but I'll still say a few words. Lucian is the chief trade economist of the European Commission. Until 2008, he held various positions at the UN in Geneva, dealing with trade and development issues. And prior to that, he was a trade negotiator with the Romanian Ministry of Foreign Affairs. He has written extensively on EU trade policy, the development impact of trade policies, WTO negotiations, regional trade agreements, competition policy, or public procurement. He obtained his PhD from the University of Manchester and a postgraduate diploma from Oxford University. Our second speaker is Professor Torben Andersen. Torben Andersen is a professor at the Department of Economics and Business Economics at Aarhus University. He holds an MSc from the London School of Economics, a license from Aarhus University, and a PhD from Corée, Université catholique de Louvain in Belgium. His primary research interests are the economics of the Nordic welfare model, public economics, labor economics, and the economics of pensions. Within these fields, he has published extensively in internationally recognized journals as well as books. Torben is a fellow at international research centers, including the CEPR, IZA, and CESIFO in Munich. He has been actively involved in policy advice in Denmark, the other Nordic countries, and a number of other countries, as well as the EU Commission. With regard to the organization of this lecture, I'll first give each of the two speakers about 20, 25 minutes to make their presentations. The two presentations will then be followed by a questions and answers session, which I will moderate. Okay, I think that's it. Let's start. I think, Lucian, you have the floor.
Okay, thank you, Mark. Good morning, everyone. DDG, thank you for this excellent opportunity for us to share with you some of the issues that by now there's no need for me to tell you how topical they are. Trade policy is at a fundamental juncture, I think, and this event here, it's a timely idea. I think people who organized it wanted to do so even before the U.S. elections, but after U.S. elections, I think this is even more important, and not just the U.S. election. There are other events in Europe which also trigger a fundamental rethink of the way we do trade policy, or maybe even more so the way we communicate about trade policy, the way we deal with adjustment costs that stem inter alia from trade policy. So I'm very grateful to be here. I'm very grateful to the organizers that gave us, the Europeans, the first shot at the issue. It's a very complicated issue, and by no means we have all the answers today. At least I don't have all the answers to all the questions that are going to be relevant for our debate. But as I said, I think it's extremely important for us to tackle this issue up front, and what I will try to do is to present only one instrument of the many things that we in Europe have been trying to do for years. They are probably very little known. If you talk to people who were on the streets opposing CETA, and if you would mention the European Globalization Fund to them, I'm not sure if they knew exactly what it is, how it works, and how important it is or should be. But this is where we are. So I think this is another opportunity for us to realize the importance of putting forward all the elements that pertain to trade policy, to separate the noise, the things that people say about trade which are not true, and then focus on the most important things that I need to tackle. And probably trade adjustment is one of these important things to tackle. So perhaps I should take that. Yeah. What I intend to do today is to present very briefly the way in which the European Globalization Fund, as I said, which is one of the main instruments that we have at EU level, how it has been working so far, and I will take the opportunity today to present to you a little bit in an avant-première, if you want, the findings of a forthcoming report produced by our colleagues in Director General for Employment, which are the ones in charge of this fund. That report will be published shortly, and it continues to be an area where we invest a lot in trying to understand the effectiveness of the fund over the years. We implement it for a while, but there's very little information. If you Google European Globalization Fund, I think you will not find too many academic papers. You will find some information from the European Commission, but I think we need to put forward a clear case of why instruments like this are probably an effective tool to tackle some of the trade adjustment costs. So, in fact, the European Globalization Fund was put forward by the former WTO Director General, by, at the time, Trade Commissioner Pascal Lamy. He is the one who understood probably very clearly the need to combine a very ambitious trade agenda with a complement, which is to say that we need to be aware of the fact that trade leads to adjustment costs, including in the labor market. I don't think it would be honest to say that if we sign an FTA, there will be no people who will need to change jobs. So if that is the case, how do we accompany those people in finding a new job in the labor market in the same sector or in another sector? So this is the underlying rationale of the European Globalization Fund. It was established in 2006. It had to go through the official decision-making process in Europe, approved Council, European Parliament, so it became operational 1 year later. In 2013, we had a significant revision of the conditions of the fund, also to try to adapt to the new realities and try to also help people who may not necessarily be the most affected by globalization as we conceive it. And I'll give you the definition of globalization as it is in our EGF legislation, but we try to expand the scope of EGFs to cover as many types of unemployed people as possible, including the self-employed, the young graduates who never worked but are still looking for a job, etc., etc. Even the farmers, in theory, are covered by the European Globalization Fund, although they have other instruments in Europe to avail themselves if need be. The main type of activities that the European Globalization Fund is trying to contribute to is active labor market policies, retraining, finding solutions and the kind of barriers that prevent a worker to change jobs if it's in temporary unemployment. the annual budget, I think this is important because it's one of the issues that, as you can imagine, was hotly debated by member states in the 2013 reform. The current budget is around 150 million euros in constant prices. You will see a few figures later on the use of the fund. I think this is one of the questions that we'll have to address upfront in the coming weeks and months, and in the debate that we will have in Europe. It's my personal opinion, but I think this question has to be answered upfront. Is the European Globalization Fund big enough to actually cover all the globalization-related trade adjustment costs in Europe, or in combination with other funds, since it's not the only one, does it have all the instruments and all the elements in place to be most effective? So this is the question to which this evaluation report that we just finished tried to answer, and I have a few numbers for you in a second. But first, again, very quickly to give you the main elements of the functioning of the European Globalization Fund. The definition of globalization as it is captured in our regulations is as follows. It's probably a very imperfect operational definition, but we had to have something that is easy for the applicants to actually provide evidence. It's not necessarily the best tool to prove causality, and we are not, we are fully aware that in every single case that I had to revise, we didn't actually have the ultimate evidence of causality of the job loss to an increase in imports. We didn't have the lost sale from a company that went bust because the client that used to buy from them for many years, now they buy from a company placed abroad. We're not asking companies or people to provide us with the lost sale, the invoices that didn't go through. However, I think the key elements, the key indicators that are important for us to trigger the use of the European Globalization Funds are well thought of. The increase in imports is clearly an evidence of people employed by European firms having increased competition from abroad. A major shift in trade in goods and services is not just the increase in imports. If they lose exports in a main market as a result of many factors, but you can even think of actions taken by that partner country. If you are selling 80% of your products to a particular market and the trade policy environment in that country changes suddenly, and all of a sudden you cannot sell your fruits and vegetables, for instance, or your fish or whatever product you are selling to that country, you would be legally qualified if the member state in question decides to put forward a case for you to benefit from the European Globalization Fund. The same goes for delocalization. And we added in the reform also, it was there, but we had to actually reinforce this idea of the impact of a major global economic crisis. So whether you think this is part of globalization or not, we decided to have it as a separate item under which member states can actually submit a case to benefit from the European Globalization Fund. So on the mechanics, this is my last slide on how it works, and then we will see some of the numbers that have come out now from the most recent evaluation exercise we had of the European Globalization Fund. So I think these are the basic questions that we have to keep in mind. It's the member states that have to put forward a case and apply for EGF to be triggered. They have to submit a proposal that includes very clearly defined operational active labor market policy measures. They have to indicate, it's a kind of a thick application file that member states have to submit with the kind of things that they are prepared to do with the money that they will get from the EGF. A key element, I think, that has to be borne in mind is that EGF does not intervene alone. EGF only co-finances actions that member states will eventually, ultimately, be responsible to put in place for the unemployed people in their country. So the EGF will finance 60% of the cost of these active labor market policies. The rest can be paid from the central state budget, from the regional budgets. It can be also a public-private partnership. I think we're flexible enough on that. And then in terms of implementation, typically we have seen, and I think this is what we have in the rules, we favor activities that do not take too long in order to unfold. We want the fund to be, in a way, a rapid reaction function. So the activities have to be carried out in maximum 2 years from the moment the funds are disbursed. Now, a little bit more on the operational criteria. Not every single worker that loses his or her job will trigger an application from a member state to the EGF. It has to have a significant critical mass, so that it requires a European level intervention. So here are the main elements that will qualify such a request from a member state. We have to have at least 500 workers that have lost their jobs, and that has to be over a period of 4 months. It can include not just the companies that would have such an increase in imports or a decline on market share, all the criteria I presented before. It can also be their suppliers. If it's part of a supply chain of a sector that has local ramifications, if all of them are negatively affected through this trickle-down effect, and if they are all suffering from job losses, they can be included in the 500 workers benchmark. We have some derogations, of course. In some very peculiar cases, at regional level or in very specific sectors, the 500 workers actually becomes a criterion that is too hard to comply. If you think of a remote region, say someone in the Canary Islands, or a very specialized occupation or economic activity, having 500 workers in that particular sector, in that particular region, may actually be too hard to comply. However, if for that specific region or sector this is an important kind of adjustment cost, it can be applied with this derogation clause. But then additional evidence is required from member states to substantiate this case-by-case, this exceptional application. I think most of our cases, I don't have the numbers in mind, but I think most of them do not need such a derogation. I'm not sure if the derogation has ever been used. I could check. But I think the most, as you'll see, most of the cases are in the mainstream criteria. You may think, why is EGF the instrument that we are now focusing our attention on when it comes to trade policy and adjustment? As I said, there are many other elements that actually play a strong role in Europe. But I think the European Globalization Fund has a set of unique features. If you think about trade policy in Europe, it is a community, we used to think it's an exclusive European Union competence, but now with CETA we realize that can be debated in some corners. Nevertheless, trade is a European Union instrument, and if it has effects in member states or in regions of member states, I think it only goes hand in hand with the idea that a European instrument, some sort of European intervention, needs to be put in place. And you think of one of the latest papers and conclusions of the European Council that included trade policy. Heads of states of European member states, all of them acknowledge the critical importance of trade for growth. And they said, well, in the long run, the trade policy agenda that we have currently put in place could lead to up to 2% increase in EU GDP. But at the same time, if such a major positive economic contribution to the European economic activity is derived from trade, if we know that at the same time some people are going to be negatively affected, it goes without saying that out of the 2% of GDP increases, we can largely contribute to the reinsertion of these people in the labor market in order to make sure that nobody is left behind. So I think this is the rationale for the EGF, and that's why the European Globalization Fund should, in my view, play a stronger role, at least in the way we communicate on trade policy and the way we tackle the negative effects that sometimes occur on a temporary level. So now I would like to move to already some of the findings of this evaluation report that, as I said, will be published very shortly. In the first graph, you see the number of cases that have been put forward by member states over the years for EGF financing. A large majority of them, the application process is done hand in hand by the European Commission and the member state. We guide the member states to make sure that they have all the elements in place to qualify. So in the end, the success rate of an application is fairly high. I think we've rejected only very few applications from member states. The vast majority of them are approved for financing. And you see that, take the last year, for instance, one surprising finding is that there are not that many application cases. Under the globalization criteria I presented earlier, we only had 4 cases this year. Now, below you see a little bit more, the more important elements beyond just the number of cases that we financed. You see the amount of money we spent on such active labor market policies and the number of people that have been included in the program. So again, if you look on the left-hand side scale, you'll see the money. And on the right-hand scale, you see the people. So last year, almost 7,000 people were covered by EGF cases. You see a little bit of a decline in the amount of money. And this is one of the puzzling elements, in fact, which again goes back to this question I posed earlier. How big should the EGF be? At the moment, the 150 million budget has really never been used. Entirely. Some of the reasons behind are currently being explored. There are many competing questions and answers to that fact. I'll go back to that. But the fact remains that despite a major, I think we should all agree that there's still a major problem in Europe with unemployment. Despite that, if you look at the applications for the EGF, I would personally call it surprisingly low. Now, the evaluation report tried to create a bit of a, you could call it firm-level data type of approach. They had extremely detailed data collection. They went and talked to the people who are actually beneficiaries of this program over the years. And one of the key metrics that the evaluation report tried to establish and measure was the re-employment rate. It goes without saying, this is the ultimate objective of any labor market intervention, and we were very curious to see what is the success rate of us spending money from EGF trying to help people finding a new job after losing their job for a variety of reasons. So you see that we have here 13 cases that were in-depth evaluated, talking to the workers that were affected by and who eventually benefited from the program, with the member state administration that administered these active labor market policies. There are many people who are managers, project officers of trainings, of all sorts of other activities. So everyone was interviewed. And what we found was in these 13 cases, which we tried to be as representative as we could in terms of sectors and member states, the re-employment rate was around 58% on average. We had a previous evaluation of the EGF before being reformed, and in that period we had a little bit of a lower re-employment rate, up to 50%. As to give you a flavor of the kind of actions and sectors that were covered by EGF, we have obviously manufacturing, machinery, basic metals, kind of products that are not necessarily sophisticated, but also car parts, car manufacturer, not necessarily the big ones that you're used to see on the streets. But there is a very thriving automotive sector that are suppliers to the big car producers. So these were the ones that were affected, and we tried to help them with EGF. Now, the higher employment rates are to some extent driven by a number of countries that have managed to do extremely well with EGF funds. So we see higher employment rates in countries like Ireland, Italy, Spain, and Finland. And you will see that when the report is published, I will not enter into too many details now, but there is a very strong interplay and a very strong correlation between labor market specificities at national level and the success of the EGF. So I can already give you one of the key conclusions of the report, which with which I'm clearly in tune, is that the success of a European-level intervention depends critically on the member state policies, the conditions that are prevalent in that country, and probably what we should do now as a second step in the evaluation is try to derive the best practices from some of our member states and see to what extent the same best practices, not just for EGF, best practices in general on labor market can be deployed in other member states. So it cuts across a number of instruments and policies that we have at the European level, even in the so-called European semester debate, the debates on the way you should run domestic policies and coordinate at European level. Clearly, some of those elements that come from the evaluation of EGF and the labor market policies from one member state to another, we need to be a little bit more attentive to best practices that can be replicated in other countries. Because clearly, in some countries, the low re-employment rates we've seen for EGF, it's hard to say it's because of the EGF actions, which are very often horizontal in nature. They are very similar, but at the end of the day, what matters is the labor market situation in the member state. Now, I hope you will not judge me too harshly on my attempt to, my two cents kind of attempt to answer the big question of how big the EGF should be and why is the EGF underutilized and is it really underutilized? So, of course, here, as I said, this is by no means any attempt to give a definitive answer, but I couldn't stop myself to actually get a first stab at the issue and try to understand a little bit what are the elements that will guide us towards a more more serious answer. So the question is, well, how many job losses in Europe over the years or last year or the year before can be actually be attributed to what we cover in the regulation as globalization? In other words, do we have a lot more jobs that would be eligible under those criteria that I presented to you, but for a number of reasons did not come to the fore in the application process? So to capture that gap, we used a series of reports from a European agency. There's a European agency that produces the so-called European Restructuring Monitor Quarterly Reports. So these are reports on a quarterly basis on big announcements of job losses and job creation. They scan all the existing evidence, not just in the media, but also with national authorities and other sources of information, whereby companies announce either the reduction or the creation of more than 100 jobs. So if a company like Caterpillar, for instance, in Belgium, when they said that they will cut I think there were 2,000 jobs, it will be in the data. When Volkswagen announces that they will cut I don't know how many jobs globally, then this will be announced and this quarterly report will capture the job losses, which I think it's a decent proxy, at least at this stage, to capture those 500 workers criterion that we have in the legislation. So concentrated big announcements of job losses will be in the gray area. But similarly, companies will announce a new investment plan, opening a new plant. You will have similar announcement of major job creation instances from the same data sources. So you see here, there is a gap between the job losses and the job creation, which you can also see in the reports. Sometimes the companies, when they announce, at least on the job losses, they will tell you what's the main driving force for Caterpillar to close down the factory in Valonia. And they could probably argue that it's their own multinational company plans and restructuring. They can say it's just plain bankruptcy, or it could be just relocation to another country. Now, of course, from these announcements, it's hard to, as I said, and I will repeat it, I'm not arguing that this is the ultimate picture of how many jobs are lost because of globalization, but it gives us an idea about the potential gap. That these are the gap between the gray and the blue will give you a pool of workers that could probably, at first sight, qualify if member states and if everything else, all the other criteria will be complied with, to apply for EGF financing. Well, if you take this as the metric of the full set of the number of people that would be eligible for EGF, you would see that the current EGF intervention will cover about 18% of these net job losses. Now, again, it's very difficult to know how much of the job losses are triggered by the kind of criteria that we have in the legislation. There are many other elements that you have to comply with, so it's hard to say whether the potential is just 20% out of the total potential. But still, you could see that perhaps there's room for improvement. If we cover only one-fifth of the job losses, that one way or another, perhaps some of them could still be seen to comply with the conditions in the EGF legislation, that will allow us to have a stronger impact on the ground, as opposed to nowadays having people unemployed and some EGF money sitting in a bank account in Brussels. This is the question. How do we make sure that we make this equation a little bit more efficient? As I said, the key reflection process that is now triggered by this second serious evaluation, in-depth evaluation of the EGF, again, covers a number of elements that are extremely important to the functioning of the EGF. The intervention criteria. Of course, as I said, one has to at least have a reflection on whether the intervention criteria are best designed to, as I said, to cover as many people as possible, as long as they are one way or another linked to this pressure from globalization. The scope of the regulation, as I said, we expanded the scope of the regulation in 2013 to cover also self-employed, to cover young graduates who never had a job, but they would be willing to have a job and they are in the labor market. To what extent the deficiencies or the difference between existing member state labor market policies and best practices that we have, at least in another neighboring country in Europe, the difference between these labor market policies, can that be something that we can improve? Of course, that's not for the European Commission to do so, but if we identify that as a major element, I think it's our duty to put it forward in the discussions with our member states. The co-funding coefficients. This is a very important element, since if you are a member state who is trying to put in place long-term or all sorts of instruments that will prevent you from having job losses from globalization, there are other funds at EU level that are far more generous. If you take the European Social Fund, for instance, the co-financing rate for the European Social Fund is higher than the Globalization Fund. So if you are a member state with a strong pressure on your national budget, and you still want to spend some money to make sure that people are not ending up in unemployment, if you have a choice between the European Globalization Fund and the European Social Fund, in the long run, and also because the European Social Fund covers 85% of the cost, and because it can actually be applied prior to the job losses, it has this long-term effect to prevent job losses, there is a bit of an unfair competition between two European funds there, because of course one offers more interesting conditions to our member states than the other. So the European Globalization Fund, it's a bit of a if the first parachute doesn't open, to use a metaphor from people jumping out of planes, they always have two parachutes. If the first big one doesn't function, you always have a second one. And the European Globalization Fund seems to function now as the smaller, the kind of parachute that you only trigger when the first one doesn't seem to work well. The European Employment Initiative is another fund which also has more flexible intervention criteria than the Globalization Fund. As I said, it's very targeted to youth unemployment in Europe, and it has a number of conditions that make it, I think, comparatively speaking, easier to use than the EGF. So to conclude, if I would go out in the streets and try to argue with people who are against globalization or against trade policy in Europe and say, wait a second, but you know, there are some elements that we don't deny that there are adjustment costs, and not that we don't deny it, we actually have active instruments to tackle it, and we have EGF and this and that, and probably I will lose the conversation before I finish my phrase. So it's a fact that the European Globalization Fund is, by all metrics, compared to any other instruments we have, it's a small fund. It's not even part of our annual financing. It's an ad hoc kind of a leftover out of all the debates we have on member states to fix the European budget. So it's not a mainstream budgetary instrument. It's very small compared to others, and it has a number of conditions which, well, they are justified because you don't want to finance any people who lose their jobs. You have to tailor it to some sort of link to globalization. But nevertheless, the conditions, according to some, are more stringent than for other competing European funds, which in the end may reach the same objectives. I think we also need to combine the messages on impact of trade, not just with the trade gains and the jobs created, something we've been doing for quite a while and quite successfully in advocating this. As long as we do not put in the same paragraph the impact that we are dealing with in terms of trade adjustment, I think even the trade gains in the current political context are not as credible as they should. If we keep talking only about the gains from trade without necessarily explicitly saying that for those who are not among the winners in the front and the first part, we will always have instruments to make sure that in the end they are not left behind. I think that message, the two combined, makes a more credible story. So it's also a communication issue, but not just a communication. These are, you know, these are real problems. If you are among people who lost their jobs because of a number of factors, and if someone can help you, be it a European fund or otherwise, I think that can change your perception about globalization. So the reasons, as I said, to conclude, the reasons which led to the creation of the EGF a decade ago, I think today are stronger than ever. Thank you.
Thank you very much, Lucian, for this extremely interesting presentation. I'm looking forward to the discussion that will follow. Without further ado, I'll give the floor to Professor Torben Andersen, who will speak about Flexicurity.
Thank you. Which falls in to the more general discussion about how globalization would affect the public sector, the labor market. Would it make it more difficult to achieve various social goals? If we can get the starting slide here. So we have all this discussion whether globalization is really compatible with maintaining high employment, decent wages. We can interpret that in various ways, but no working poor. If you can only have high employment, if you have to accept extremely low wages, you can say that from a distributional perspective, the problem has not really been solved. So keeping low inequality and keeping an extended welfare state. So coming from the Nordic, of course, you could say this is sounds as a particular list of threats to the Nordic countries, because we are known for having very large public sectors. We are known for having very low inequality. So would the Nordic countries be examples of the first to sort of fall in this globalization wave because we have all these things? Or are there some lessons from the Nordic countries that it need not be in that way? And of course, my basic conclusion is that the Nordic experience really shows that it needs not be, or there need not be, an incompatibility between being highly globalized and attaining distributional goals, having a social balance, social cohesion, whatever you like to call it, and having an extended welfare state. Actually, the Nordic countries, if also you look at it historically, they have routinely been classified as small open economies, just another way of saying they have been very globalized, and that has been the case historically. And the extended welfare models we have been developed while we were very open and under very clear understanding that we need to be competitive. This is not something which has been achieved by thinking we have to protect ourselves from something outside, and under this protection we can develop our welfare state. Or rather, it has been what you might call an active approach under some social, distributional, political ambitions related to the welfare state, but then on the other hand also understanding that unless you have a private sector which is strong and competitive, you can simply not have this welfare state and you cannot finance it. So often this is portrayed as a conflict between market and state. And of course, if you have a large welfare state, there are some political objectives concerning the state. But in the Nordic welfare model, it's really a kind of complementarity between the market and the state. So it's very wrong to interpret as an example of politics against markets. So always been this understanding that the policies which are pursued for distributional reasons, etc., they also have to be market conform, so to speak. And there are many reasons for this, but the one and very clear one is that attaining the objectives of the Nordic model is simply not possible if you cannot have a high employment rate. This is important for the financing of the welfare model, and it's also important for maintaining low inequality. I'll come back to that. Just a few numbers. I don't want to go deep into this. Of course, we can discuss at length how to measure globalization and what is really meant by this concept. I just took three country rankings which are often used, the globalization index, the ease of doing business, and the competitiveness. And you can see that the Nordic countries rank very high in this. And if you look at my own country, Denmark, you can see that we are ranked in top 10, both in terms of globalization and ease of doing business. So it's not an example of a country, or the Nordic countries are not examples of countries who have tried to shield themselves from competition, rather the opposite. So to bring this into the big question, namely living standards or income per capita, which is what is often in focus in the trade discussion. We have these gains from trade, and it's standard understanding they would create more income, more wealth, and higher living standards. So that would be one dimension, which is up. And then you have income equality in the other dimension. So we have sort of a trade-off or concern that we would like to have high living standards, but we also like to have low inequality. Of course, there can be political differences in terms of how you will weight these two things compared to each other. But of course, there is these two dimensions in that. And of course, where the Nordic countries stand out and why there's so much focus on the Nordic countries is that we have managed to attain reasonably high incomes, usually in top 10 or close to top 10 in terms of income per capita in the OECD. And of course, as we all know, relatively low inequality. So how come that this has been possible to combine or achieve both of these things, especially when you take into account that if, say, let's use the US as comparison, the tax burden is roughly double in the Nordic countries to what it is in the US, 25 compared to around 50. And the trade share in the Nordic countries is sort of just a usual trade measure, export and import relative to GDP is between 50 and 60%, and in the US it's 20%. So we have these small open economies, extremely open to trade, very large public sectors, and still they have managed to perform reasonably well. I don't want to claim that everything is perfect in the Nordic countries. There's been many problems, many crises, but still the performance, and not just over 1 year, over a long period of time, has been fairly good in a comparative perspective. So this suggests that there is something here on the issue how you can maintain or build up and maintain an extended welfare state and still be very open or very globalized. And I've already mentioned this, but really, if you should put it down to the essence of the Nordic model, it's actually an employment contingent or dependent model. When you have an extended welfare state and you have higher tax burden, high taxes, and you have generous social benefits, then obviously if employment goes down, you have a very severe double effect. You have more expenditures on transfers and less tax revenue. And clearly, the more ambitious, the higher the transfers, the higher the taxes, the larger this budget effect. So if we do not succeed in maintaining a high employment rate, we would simply not be able to afford our welfare state. So this duality or understanding of, yes, we have this extended thing, but on the other hand, we can only finance it if we have high employment rate. And of course, high employment rates are also important for having high living standards. It's, as I'll argue later, also important for maintaining low inequality. So that's really indicating that this balance or need to combine the social objectives with something which is market conform is essential to the Nordic model. Just one graph to illustrate this here. You have age and you have the employment rate as depending on age. The green dotted line is the highest employment rate for any age you find in any OECD country, so it's not just one country. For some ages, it's Japan and Iceland and so on, and the purple is the lowest one. And of course, the point here is that the Nordic countries are very close to defining the ceiling for employment rates, despite having very high tax rates and very high social transfers. Usually, maybe I exaggerate a little bit, but on page one in a standard textbook, it would say if you have very high taxes and very high benefits, you'll have huge problems with work incentives, and then you pay a price in terms of low employment. And the Nordic countries is a contradiction to that. And of course, the question is, what makes this work then? And I'll come back to that. Another point related to inequality, which is illustrated in this graph, which is slightly complicated, but it's not that complicated. The green line measures how inequality deviates from the OECD average inequality in income distribution. So if it's positive, there's more inequality. If it's negative, there's less inequality. Then this difference is split in what can be attributed to the inequality in the distribution of market income, that is, incomes before taxes and transfers, and what can be attributed to redistribution via taxes and transfers. So if you look at Norway and Denmark to the left, you can see we have much lower inequality, we know that, and you can see that the blue and the red column are roughly of the same size. So it's saying that half the reason why we have low inequality is actually that already when people sort of return from work, we have low inequality, and then on top of that, we redistribute more. But of course, the point here is that already when you look at the labor market outcome, we have something which is pretty equal or has low inequality, and then on top of that, we have political ambitions to do a bit more. So this blue column here is very important in understanding the Nordic countries, that the labor market policy, the structuring of the labor market, educational policy and so on makes this important, and in that way has created the basis both for low inequality and high living standards. So let's look a little bit more into the Danish case and the Danish flexicurity model, which has been much in focus. Of course, it's tempting being a Danish to say this is a specific Danish thing. It is not a specific Danish thing. You find similar things in other countries, but perhaps we see some of these things more clearly in the Danish case, but you find similar things even in the Netherlands, in Sweden, and so on. So, but the point here is that it's really made up of three things, or three pillars, although it has a name which suggests that there are only two pillars, namely the flexibility part and the security part. The flexibility part is that there's very lax rules for employers in terms of hiring, that's not so controversial, but in firing workers. So it's very easy to lay off workers at very short notice and small cost. Then the security part is the generous social safety net, or in particular the unemployment insurance scheme, which by comparative standards is generous. So that's the flexicurity, literally interpreted from the name. But that's really not giving the full picture, because the third pillar, namely the active labor market policy, is very crucial. And we have almost a controlled experiment on this in Denmark, because in the 70s and 80s, where Denmark was clearly not a case highlighted as an example to follow, we had very high unemployment. We had the flex and the security part, but the active labor market pillar was very weak. So what happened in the 90s was a sequence of reforms which strengthened the active labor market part, labor market policy part, and then unemployment came down. And that's why I say it's a semi-controlled experiment, that you need all three ingredients for this to work. And importantly here, the active labor market policy is doing basically two things. One is empowerment, that those who are unemployed, they might be put on training, things to re-qualify, to find another job. So that's important. The other part is an incentive thing, because if you have high social transfers, unemployment benefits, of course there is an incentive issue. So what the active labor market policy is also doing is that there are requirements. You cannot just claim these benefits. If you have been unemployed for a certain period of time, you'll be asked to participate in certain programs. And of course that affects your incentive to actually search for a job. And there's lots of conditions built into this which I will not have time to go into. So it's important here, it combines flexibility and security. It has very strong focus on maintaining job search incentives, and it has very strong focus on maintaining or building human capital, so people who are laid off have a reasonable chance of finding another job. So here's, this is just the unemployment rate, Denmark, OECD and EU, to show that we have consistently had a lower unemployment rate in comparative perspective. At the onset of the financial crisis, many were saying, well, that's fine, Denmark has had low unemployment before the crisis, but it's easy to have this to work when the economy is booming or in there's high growth, but in a crisis, this model would really be in deep trouble. And of course, we have been affected by the crisis and unemployment went up, but despite the crisis, we are still in a position where unemployment is low. We have, comparatively speaking, low youth unemployment, and we have very low long-term unemployment. Long-term unemployment has increased, but very, very moderately, despite the crisis. So what's important here is that the underlying level of turnover in the labor market is very high. On the graph, you see with the blue line, the inflows to jobs, and the dotted red line is outflows. And you can see they're pretty close to each other. There are periods where the blue is above the dotted line, the red dotted line, and vice versa. But if you look at the scale, it's between 20 and 25%. So that means that the number of jobs which are in the country, say, January 1st, 1 year, and you look 1 year later, then about 20, 25% of those jobs are not there anymore. That's quite a lot. But of course, luckily, about 20, 25% new jobs have been created. So that means that a lot of people affected by loss of job, unemployment, luckily most are only affected by unemployment in a very short spell of time and return into job. So this movement in and out of job is very high. That's of course explaining why long-term unemployment is low, because even if you're unlucky losing your job, there's always a lot of job openings, and if you have the qualifications, there's a good chance you'll find yourself a job. And of course also for youth, since there are a lot of job openings, entry for youth is more easy. So this is a chart with all EU countries. What you see here is from one quarter to the next, what happens with those who become unemployed, and you look at them one quarter later. The blue column is saying how many found themselves a job within one quarter. And in Denmark, it's around 40%, and you can see by far the highest in the EU and signaling this, basically the flexibility part of the labor market. But of course, also for workers, the very strong implication that there are always job openings. And you saw, even if it had a dip during the financial crisis, the level of job creation was still pretty high. So this mechanism has been robust despite the crisis. Here's a chart. The intention is not that you should look at all these separate columns. Just if you look out here, this is the changes during the crisis, of where we, before the crisis, had increases in employment, and after the crisis had decreases in employment. What you see here is the change in employment across sectors. And this is only to underline a point, a question which is often asked, which say, okay, you have this high level of turnover, isn't that just temporary layoffs, that people are asked to go home? And then the implicit understanding is that they should return to the same employer. Of course, that exists, but that's not an important part in the Danish labor market. This illustrates there's been a lot of relocation of labor across sectors. So in that sense, the model is flexible in relocating labor, depending on where need is going down and where need is increasing. And that, of course, is reinforcing the flexibility in the labor market. Now, since we have this high turnover, and since the risk of becoming unemployed is relatively high, you could think that most people would perceive a lot of uncertainty in the labor market, and that's actually not the case. Here you have some survey results taken from the Eurobarometer, and you have Denmark compared to the EU average, just to make it simple. And you can see, if you ask people, how do you assess your personal job situation? Very, very many consider it to be very good or rather good, and very few consider it to be bad. So there is, even though we have this turnover, there is a very strong sense of security in the system. And that also applies if you ask questions related to globalization. Is globalization an opportunity? That's the first on the other graph. The first question, and the other one is asking whether it's a threat. And you can see most people, they consider it as an opportunity and another threat. And that's, of course, in all of what I've been speaking about, there is an implicit or social insurance that, of course, there are costs from globalization. Of course, there are closures. People are laid off, etc. But there is a collective insurance. The costs are not fully borne by individuals, but are shared in this system. So that's, of course, an important thing here. Another important thing is the education and the qualifications, which I've already mentioned. And there are many dimensions to this. One is, of course, we have an extended public education system where all education is basically tax-financed. And we also have a very elaborate system of labor market training, which you could call lifelong learning. So that means that many people have their skills or qualifications updated, even when they have a job. So it's not only targeted to those who lose the job and you go in and try to provide them with necessary qualifications to find a job. There's also continuous training of most people. You can see here that an indicator of lifelong learning that Denmark stands out with a very high level here. Of course, the flip side of this is that you don't get anything costlessly. So we spend a lot of money on education, public money on education. We have the highest level in the OECD of public financing of general education, slightly more than 6% of GDP. We also have the highest level of expenditures on active labor market policies. So that's, of course, the cost side of the social or implicit insurance in the welfare state. But on the other hand, it also has the effect of strengthening employment and in that way the economic base of maintaining this thing. Clearly, there are challenges and threats in the labor market, and this thing about education and skills is important. We know it's extremely well established in the literature, all sorts of studies, macro and micro studies, a very strong link between education, employment rate, wages, and even other things, social engagement and so on, but also retirement and health and so on. What you see in the graph, the blue column is the employment rates across three broad groups of education, just to illustrate that employment rates are higher the qualifications of the individuals. And the purple column is showing the share of the labor force who has this level of education. So, and we can discuss at length whether globalization or new technology or other forces are affecting the labor market. Often it's impossible to separate them, but sort of broadly interpreted, we have that the threat is mostly on those with low skills, and the new opportunities are mostly created for those who have skills and qualifications. Actually, not necessarily only for those with the higher skills, but also for those with the medium levels of skills. Some recent research points actually to the importance of the quality of medium levels educations in this respect. But we have these sort of opposite forces. And of course, the ideal policy response is then to move people up in the educational distribution, reduce the group who do not really get labor market relevant qualification and get more to attain medium or high levels of education. And that's again bring all the educational policy into the picture again, which is important not only for the employment level but also for the distributional objectives. So that's a recurrent theme. We always have to reconsider where these arrows are working and how we can change the educational system and also the updating of qualification, lifelong learning while people are in the labor market. So to conclude, the Nordic countries is an example of globalization not having implied a retrenchment of welfare arrangement. We have been able to maintain the extended welfare state. We have been able to maintain high income levels and a relatively low level of inequality. In the particular flexicurity context, employment is very high. We have very few working poor. We have coped with large adjustments in the labor market relatively smoothly. Of course, there have been problems, but the broad picture is that it has worked out relatively smoothly. And the active policy approach has been very important in that respect. That applies to the active labor market policy in trying to make people go back into jobs quickly again if they lose their job, and of course all the education qualification part I talked about. It's not a crisis-free model. We have also in the Nordic countries have seen very severe crises, but we have managed to cope with them. And you can also see a long list of reforms, continuously reforming labor market policies, educational policies to balance these changes. It's not something you fix once and for all. There are continuous changes which you have to cope with. And the main challenge today in all the Nordic countries is to reduce the share of the fraction of the youth who enter the labor market with very low qualifications. Because you can predict with a very high probability that they will have a hard time finding themselves a job. If they find a job, it would either be with a relatively low wage, or it would be a job where they're in or out of employment, because those type of jobs are typically much more marginalized and less secure. Yeah, thank you for your attention.
Thank you very much, Torben, for this very interesting presentation. I think the two presentations are quite complementary. I've got a long list of questions, but I think I'll give an opportunity to people in the room to ask their own questions first. Floor is yours. Yeah, Marcelo.
Thank you very much for very interesting and informative presentations. I have a question to each of you. First to Torben. You put the emphasis on the education system and active labor market policies as a source of what explains the low inequality in Denmark. I'm convinced by your arguments. I was wondering whether you can tell us a little bit more about the relative importance of each of these in explaining the low income inequality, and perhaps something on the potential role that population growth, the low population growth, I guess, in Denmark may have in explaining this. And I'm not sure where there is something to say about immigration either, so I'm not sure what the reality is about immigration into Denmark. And then to Lucian, so I'm going to go back to the old question in trade adjustment and whether we should have a trade adjustment program, whether the European Union social fund is not enough. Do we really need a program that will tackle specifically the shocks associated? So there was a big debate back in the 80s and on whether we need adjustment programs for workers that are associated with trade shocks, or whether we shouldn't simply have adjustment programs as the European Union has, the European Social Fund, I think was the name you gave, which tackles any kind of shock. And the question I'm asking this is that it's very tough to link what happens in the labor market to a specific trade shock. So if you think about, you required an increase in imports to show that you need to have access to the fund, that you can have access to the fund if there is an increase in imports. The unemployment can be trade related without an increase in imports. So you can have import competition that leads to innovation, which is labor saving. And at the end of the day, you have replaced workers by robots. So that doesn't. There is not much imports. The competition was potentially an increase in imports that lead to innovation. Robots appear, workers are gone, and you have displacement. So you wouldn't be able to call for the globalization fund, and where it's really a trade shock. So on the link between the two, and whether we really need something that is trade specific.
Thanks for the question, Marcelo. Do you want to answer immediately, or should I collect two or three questions? What do you prefer? I'll take a couple more then. Juan?
Thank you very much. Very interesting presentations indeed. I have one question for each of you. To Professor Andersen, when I look at your explanation about how flexible the labor market seems to work, it seems kind of an Anglo-Saxon story about labor market. But I wonder whether there are a couple of other factors that are also into play here. Some is probably the average size of the employers in Denmark, probably, which, if I understand correctly, are mostly small and medium-sized enterprises overall. And then something that I think you didn't touch upon is the actual involvement of social partners in actual policy making. So this type of cooperation that develops over the years, over decades probably, between government, social partners, enterprises, unions, etc., in establishing this type of policies and cooperation at the firm level that allows for this flexibility without the worker being or feeling being actually affected or hampered by this type of very flexible labor market policies, as you mentioned. So probably you may, it would be interesting if you could elaborate on that. And then to Lucian, one question. This trade adjustment program, it strikes me as a big firm program. You have this threshold of 500 people being made redundant. I wonder whether it is at the sector or firm level. If it is at the firm level, it seems like quite a high threshold to pass. And I was wondering whether, you know, coming back to your question as to whether the fund is big enough, you asked that question, and then at the same time you showed a slide saying no, but at the same time we are not using all the money. We have only 4 applications last year. So I was wondering whether one option would be actually to reduce potentially the threshold to cater for basically to expanding the base of the program in a way. If you think in terms, as Marcelo mentioned, some of these issues happen not necessarily through trade in traditional terms, but investment flows, for example, so affecting retail distribution sectors or things like that. And there you have very small employers. Thank you.
Thanks, Roberta.
So thank you very much to both, actually, for very good presentations. I've been thinking for a question to both, given that we're doing an equal share of questions. So I have one for Lucian on the European Global Fund. So it seems to me from your presentation that somehow there is a favor to target large firms. So somehow, if the shock is a trade shock, those who would mainly suffer would be small firms. So somehow, probably, if the driver of the shock has to be a trade shock, I mean, the cause of the shock has to be a trade shock, then it's a bit sort of strange that particularly those that the fund target are the larger enterprises. And for Professor Andersen, I was thinking that, again, if the advice is let's try to have educated workforce that can flexibly adjust, somehow what seems to be the shock is a technological shock. It creates opportunity for high skills. So, of course, if you have a workforce that is high skilled and it's a technological shock that is the cause of the problem, then you adjust. So my question to you, would that work when the shock is a trade shock that doesn't necessarily, maybe yes in the case of Denmark, but in some countries may not necessarily be a shock that redirect jobs toward the high scale? I mean, should we say all countries do target high skills? That's the thing at the global level.
Okay, I see that there are quite a few more questions, but I think I'll give you an opportunity to answer this those three questions, and then we'll have another round of questions. I mean, who wants to start? Torben?
Yeah, thank you for these questions. Let me try to answer them in order. Marcelo, on the possibility of separating education and active labor market policy, of course, they are interrelated, so it's difficult to make a sharp. But as I briefly said, we had this almost controlled experiment on the active labor market policy in the Danish case, where we could actually see the importance of this and sort of briefly put, the model did not work with weak active labor market policies. And in that period, we had high unemployment, we had a problem with long-term unemployment, of course, and that was also a period where we had problems with our public finances, deficits and growing debt and so on. So you could say that at that time, we had a welfare model which was not sustainable. And then we had these reforms and we got into another trajectory, so to speak. So that's at least underlying the importance of the active labor market policy. The education part has, one way to phrase it is that there's always been an objective to avoid working poor, and that's also related to the social partners. I'll come back to that. So you can think of it, we have a system where we have pretty high minimum wages, so entry wages. And of course, if people still should have a job, they should be able sort of to jump this higher level, and that means they need the qualifications. So therefore, there's always been a strong tradition of lifting qualifications up to a level such that you can, so to speak, deserve the high wages. And that, of course, there's the educational part, the distributional part, but it also has an effect on productivity, of course, because then you have a more educated labor force. So that has been important. But that's also, now you ask about migration. Also why immigration is a particular challenge in the Nordic countries, because, and I think here in terms of immigrations from low-income countries, which usually do not have high qualification levels. So they enter this labor market where the entry level is up here. Can they jump this? Well, that would be difficult. And also, this is we have high employment rates both for men and women, so there's a gender issue in that. So when you measure, if you look at employment rates for immigrants, they are, in Denmark and Sweden, say, they are at the EU average, OECD average. But when you look at the gap, it's much larger in the Nordic countries because we have these ambitions. And that's, of course, why immigration is a very controversial issue. And we have very heated discussions had for many years in Denmark. Also in Norway, and now Sweden is also having this discussion. And that's, of course, a tricky issue. How can you reconcile a welfare state which is generous and is also has a tradition of being very open to cope with migration? So this, in my own country, the government, of course, they have tightened immigration rules as much as they can, within conventions, maybe even slightly beyond conventions, that's discussed. But they have also changed the social safety net such that there's now a kind of, you could call it, entry condition. That if you enter the country, you would not qualify for the normal security level before you have been in the country in 7 out of the last 8 years. Of course, most immigrants would not qualify for this, so they would be in a, let's call it a B system, where the transfer would be roughly 50% of what it is in the A system. So in that sense, you could say that we have started changing our welfare system from being a universal one to be a more contingent one, and that's clearly an important discussion. Then, Sean, you raised several issues in the flexibility part. Yes, it has some Anglo-Saxon flavor, but of course, importantly, with all the safety net attached to it. Then the role of the size of the firms in Denmark, clearly, the structure is that we have very many small and medium-sized firms. So that, therefore, you could say, well, it's natural that you have some of this insurance need carried collectively rather than in the firms, because a larger firm could easier do that than a small firm. But still, it cannot be the entire explanation, because luckily we have some variation across the Nordic countries. So Denmark, historically, a lot of small, medium-sized firms. Sweden, a lot of large firms. So you can see some differences in EPL between Denmark and Sweden, which can be explained in this. But in terms of active labor market policy and in terms of the social safety net, we are more or less the same. So it cannot be the only explanation. It is still coming back to this with the active labor market policy and education as being important at the end of the day. Then you bring up the social partners, and that's extremely important in a Nordic context. All these things, and I briefly mentioned the historical thing, they have the social partners have played a tremendous role, and there's also been a tradition of where sort of the social partners, they sort of have a first move advantage. If they can come to an agreement, then usually policymakers would accept it, unless it's very sort of outrageous. But that's usually not the case, because they also understand that they need to find a compromise, and it's, you could say, it's also part of small countries that a tradition of more consensus-based policies have evolved. So, of course, there are conflict between the social partners, but still this thing about competitiveness and understanding the requirements to be competitive, that has been sort of a common denominator in much of this. Roberto, on the type of education, yes, one can think various types of changes which would affect different skill levels differently. I think in one important thing from some recent research is this thing about the importance of the quality of very broadly medium levels of education. Also in the Nordic countries, in a period of time, there was sort of, high on higher education is just, we have to focus on the elite. But if you look at the trade structure, you can actually see that much of our trade is carried by medium-type education, and there's a lot of evidence showing that the quality of these types of educations are extremely important for productivity, perhaps at least as important as the quality of elite education. So that also has an important implication for how you design the educational policy. And there we have seen a lot of changes recently, for instance in my own country, from only focusing on the elite and focusing much more on the broad base level of education.
Yeah. Okay, well, thanks for the question. I think I've received essentially two questions. One from Marcelo, basically saying, why do we need a trade-specific adjustment program after all if we have so many other instruments at EU level? Well, as I try to explain in my slides, that there's a fundamental difference between the EGF and other funds, and that is that most other funds, in particular the ESF, the one you mentioned, and the one that is actually much larger in scope, in size, etc., the ESF is an ex-ante. It's a sort of restructuring fund. You perceive that the steel sector, say, is in overcapacity, and before you have people queuing up for unemployment, you try to put in place a serious industrial restructuring plan, and there are European funds for it. So that's what I call the main parachute. Yeah, if the main parachute works, that's fine. But as we see it, you know, if you look at the unemployment rate in Europe, it's clear that the main parachute doesn't work for everyone. So then the European Globalization Fund is one that is basically an ex post. The moment you are unemployed already, and the moment we see that after a year or so, basically, because it takes 2 years to, you know, 1 year to put forward the case, to put in place the measures. So if after an immediate 1 year or so of being in the unemployed pool, you don't find a job by yourself in the market, kind of labor market, then we intervene. And it's well established that, you know, it's very important to intervene and assist unemployed workers early on, as opposed to leaving them linger in the unemployment pool, then they become demotivated. There are a few other structure factors that make it even more difficult to intervene. So the EGF has two major differences. It's the moment when the main one doesn't function. It is supposed to be a quicker intervention mechanism than the ESF, which takes years for us to put in place this restructuring process. And I think the evaluation report highlights two other important elements which are, I think, truly European in nature. One is that, as I said, if you look at the labor market policies across EU member states, you will see a wide range of varieties of types of measures, you know, the political philosophy behind the social system in each country. So the EGF actually tries to create a platform for best practices to migrate. And in the report, which I don't want to ruin all these key messages, that's why I was a little bit superficial on some of these facts, but now you trigger me a more detailed response. There are clear cases, for instance, where the practices developed in EGF led to a change in the Dutch labor market policies in particular sectors, like we have a case studies on new services, design, creative media, which, believe it or not, even in such high-tech sectors, you have unemployment and people need to move away from one job to the next. And with the EGF best practices, the Dutch system now will function differently than before, thanks to these couple of EGF cases that they afterwards scaled up at national level. The second European feature, which is, I think, unique in the EGF context, although allegedly could be a lot improved, is the ability of workers who are willing to do so to move from one EU member state to the next. There are very few instruments in the, say, EU labor market landscape that will facilitate for those people who want to do so to keep their specialization or et cetera. If you don't want to retrain and become from a, you know, kind of a glass fiber worker, something in the health sector or in the touring sector, or in, if you don't want to change sectors, if you don't want to become an entrepreneur, which is all options covered by EGF, changing completely your profession. We spend like 15,000, sometimes 20,000 per worker, some member states spend, to actually re-kit, retool a worker into a totally different area. And there are good stories about it. That, or if you want to become self-employed entrepreneur, another very successful type of program, although also very expensive. But if you do not want those and you want to remain a welder, because that's what you like to do, and then if you're Portuguese and there are welder jobs, vacancies in another member state, there are very few instruments at national level that will facilitate that. Well, EGF, I think, has a great chance, to the extent that this is something that people need in Europe. We may argue in Brexit context if this is something we should promote. But nevertheless, if people are willing to go for that kind of reinsertion in the labor market, the fact remains that there are very few instruments available to them. We leave them to their own devices. Maybe with a little bit of help, you know, relocation across countries, I know personally is not easy. I've done it a few times. That would be another European unique feature of this fund, which, as I said, is not fully articulated now. Now, let me turn back to the other essentially same question from Juan and Roberta, which I think was probably due to me not fully capturing the essence of the intervention criteria. Maybe I went too fast on my slides, either orally or in writing. But I think the reality is actually the opposite of what was implied in your question. The intervention criteria that are in Article 4 in the regulation, actually there are 1, 2, 3 main criteria. And out of these three criteria, I think one is specifically aimed for SMEs, is the one which says that if during a period of 9 months, 500 workers, and it says clearly, notably in SMEs, have been laid off, not just in one region or one sector, but across sectors and regions, even two adjacent regions, say, on the border between France and Germany, if that is a nuts European region, we have this cross-border region. If that is the case, then they will qualify for EGF, particularly for SME assistance. So the 500 doesn't really apply to one enterprise only. It's actually the opposite. The main criteria, which is meant to be, whenever necessary, meant for larger firm, the 500 workers in one enterprise, it says as well, in one enterprise or in an enterprise plus their suppliers. So take the EU SME definition, which is below 250 employees. If you are yourself in the 200-odd kind of number of employees, but you have suppliers, and all of a sudden, all of them, these other suppliers, you make up the 500 threshold, you don't have to be a big firm to benefit from the 4 months immediate response. So there are different thresholds that will clearly integrate SMEs a lot more than I maybe managed to say in my slides. And the third criterion, which is not very used, but again, is meant to be used by SMEs in very small labor markets, in extremely small regions and occupations or economic activities, you would only expect SMEs to be in that category. But the fact remains, if you, apart from the legal criteria, if you look at all these cases that I summarized in my chart, a vast majority of them are actually about SMEs. Of course, there's one about Peugeot, and there are many other, Alitalia, for instance. There are some cases where big firms had to apply for it, but the vast majority of cases that have been financed by EGF are SMEs. And I think just one additional point to Marcelo's question, although I don't think you asked it explicitly, but we actually, in the report, we also have an answer to two other important questions. Are measures financed by EGF cost effective? You know, are we wasting money in EGF as opposed to the Danish system, for instance? You know, why should we spend it at EU level in an efficient way if we should all replicate the Danish system, although I doubt it's so easy as it sounds. Now, with that counterfactual, with that metric, we did not find EGF to be less effective. In fact, in many cases, it's more effective than many national governments' actions. So again, this points to the fact that from EGF, those measures that prove to be better than national reemployment rates and the cost-benefit ratio should probably be rolled out. Not EGF, don't get me wrong, not EGF. Not all EGF cases are successful. We have cases where the re-employment rate is as low as 4% in Italy. But because there is a monitoring system, we know what went wrong and why it didn't work. And as we see from the improvement re-employment rates, we are not repeating mistakes or things that didn't go as planned. But again, I think what really points to clear messages from EGF is that it's a lot more transparent, it's a lot more monitored than some of the, at least the way I see it from the European Commission. We monitor these measures and we know who these people are. When you make the application, you actually have to provide a list of the workers and you can actually monitor them, see if they have still retained their job after 12 months. Okay, they've been re-employed, but are they still in business after 12 months? We can measure those things. Job satisfaction. We can measure job satisfaction. By the way, the report finds that 60% of the re-employed did not find their job satisfaction to decline. Well, 40% did, but 60% found either higher job satisfaction or similar job satisfaction, which captures also the wage level, but not just the wage level.
Thank you very much. Unfortunately, I don't know. I mean, we are already, it's already 20 to noon, and we already passed the time that, so I don't know if the interpreters can continue. Yeah? If that's possible, I would take another round of 2-3 questions and ask you to please be relatively short so that we can finish in the next 5-10 minutes. Thank you very much. So, Mark?
Thank you. I have three questions for Mr. Cernat. One is about this notion of globalization-related adjustment costs. I was wondering, listening to you, does this cover only international economic transactions external to the EU, or does it also cover intra-EU economic transactions? For example, somebody loses his or her job in Belgium because a factory relocates to another country in the European Union. Also, on this notion of globalization-related adjustment costs, is this only about trade in goods, trade in services, or does it also cover adjustment costs that may have to do with movement of people and immigration? My second question is it the case that member states are completely free to design their own policies in this area? In other words, I mean, you talked a little bit already about that there is this complementarity between what happens at the EU level and at the member states level. But as a matter of principle, I was asking myself, are the member states completely free to design their own globalization adjustment policies? Finally, a more political question. In this whole debate in the European Union about adjustment and adjustment costs and policies, is there a particular China dimension? In other words, is there a sense that adjustment costs are particularly acute in sectors exposed to competition from China? Thank you.
Thanks, Mark, for the questions. There was a question here.
Thank you, and thank you very much for the presentations. Particularly that they are indeed complementary, and that raises to me the question, if we have a presentation at Danish level, at European level, and we find ourselves here at the WTO premises, I'll come back to this trilemma, the globalization trilemma Danny Roderick couple of years ago, who is responsible for the cost of globalization, and how can you, who should deal with it? And many people in the public debate right now say that those who deal with the benefits of globalization, free trade, etc., do not bear the cost of, do not bear the responsibility to deal with the cost of it, because that's actually left for the national governments. So how do you see this? Do you see this as a problem? And if you would see this as a problem, do you see that the responsibility for dealing with the cost of globalization should be more fair distributed over the different levels? And what does that then actually imply for the work we're doing at a regular basis here? Thank you.
Thank you. Other questions? Okay.
So thank you for the great presentation. Professor Andersen, in your report, one of the most curious parts for me at least was where you talk about this feeling of trust, sense of fairness, and the history and culture of Nordic countries, which enables the institutions that Denmark has to function properly. Now, I'm wondering if you were to advise probably the so-called messier democracies or other countries where these factors are significantly different when measured empirically, what would you suggest they do in order to replicate these cultural nuances? Professor Cernat, I may be rephrasing the previous questions asked, but in terms of justifications for adjustment policies, the three main ones that are usually offered is efficiency considerations, equity considerations, and the political economy argument. Is there this feeling that that countries are sacrificing, or the EU is sacrificing, the efficiency and equity argument in order for the political economy argument? In the sense that you see it more often in the U.S. that all these all the TAA adjustments and all the TAA changes happen right before they are passing a free trade agreement, and it seems to be done in a way that it is slightly rushed, and seems to have the political considerations of getting something through a parliament, their Congress, or like in Europe's case, parliament through. I mean, the TAA in 2015 is spending over $800 million. As part of its trade adjustment policies. With three-fifths of EU's population, it's still struggling enormously. And in terms of the provisions that people have mentioned of 500 workers, the TAA has changed its qualification standards down to the point where in the 2009 adjustment, now an individual worker can even petition. So did the EU look at the TAA's evolution when they were designing the EGF? And I mean, if generally you could also compare the two programs and talk about this political angle to specific adjustment programs.
Thank you. I think we'll stop here with the questions. I'll give you, let's say, 2.5-3 minutes each to respond to those questions. Please, I guess, Lucian, you can start.
Okay, well, let me answer rather monosyllabically now after longer answers before. Does it cover intra-EU trade? No, it's meant to cover what the word says, globalization, in the sense of increased pressure from the rest of the world. We have the single market, which is already part of our so-called domestic economic functioning, and I don't think that requires adjustment. But behind your question is actually the point that probably one of the most, if for the most integrated economic region in the world, we do not need a European Globalization Fund for ourselves. Why do we need it for the rest of the world? And that's a question we don't have time to debate now. But just to answer factually, the intra-EU trade is not covered. Are member states free to design their globalization programs? Well, to a large extent, yes. But remember one fundamental issue here about the European Globalization Fund, which I should have said from the very beginning. This is about workers. This is not about companies. So this is the limit where member states move from free to highly regulated through the competition policy in the EU context. If you say, look, I have to give a subsidy to this company because it's negatively affected by globalization, that won't work. But if you have people in unemployment and you want to send them back to university and spend as much as you want, there is, I think, very little we would say against that in a EU context. The China dimension, I didn't mention it, and there is a very good reason why I didn't mention it, because it doesn't exist. The European Globalization Fund is not meant to treat imports from one country as more detrimental than from another, so it applies on a horizontal fashion to trade, no matter who the partner is. Very quickly on the, I agree with your assessment that these are three main elements, particularly the efficiency versus the political economy. But I wonder why you reckon that by having the EGF we sacrifice on efficiency, because I don't see it that way. We don't sacrifice on efficiency by the very fact that we continue to have a very ambitious as it can be today, trade policy agenda. We sign an agreement with Canada. We just signed one, which will enter into force soon, with Ecuador. We finalized an agreement with Vietnam. I could go on this list. So this is the policy, the trade policy agenda, where efficiency through trade liberalization is not sacrificed. What the EGF does is to actually ensure fairness and the ability of our trade policy agenda to continue by making very clear the fact that we are aware at European level. It is there that the trade policy is actually implemented. Is it there that we are aware of the fact that some people need to be accompanied in between two jobs? So for me, they work very well hand in hand. We're not sacrificing any efficiency by having EGF. Quite the contrary, EGF should be probably, if you ask me, even more central to EU trade policy than it used to be. And comparison with the TAA, we're not adding simple patches every time we sign an FTA. You see in the intervention criteria, there is no mention of any FTA. This is a general trend that we are putting in place for trade adjustment mechanisms to enter whenever necessary. You can sign an FTA with Chile, say, 10, 15 years ago. If it is now that it has a major impact on a region in one country, in a particular sector, you'll have to deal with it, irrespective of its cause.
Yeah. Yes, I'll try to answer those questions briefly, which will be difficult because they're both very deep. On the benefit and cost, there are many aspects. One is, of course, that the costs are often more visible than the benefits, so there's sort of an identification issue. But at the end of the day, it comes down to having policies and institutions which can deal with this issue of compensating the losers, and therefore it's also related to the other question. Let me briefly just say a few things. One is, I think that thinking of the research and the academic work on globalization, I think you cannot find any paper on trade which would not say that they're both benefits and cost, but there are very few who really goes into the details of then how dealing with this issue of distributing the, or compensating or distributing the cost side. We have also seen a lot of focus in structural reforms, for instance on unemployment insurance, which has basically only focused on the efficiency effect of unemployment insurance. If you look at the sort of the top publications of on unemployment insurance in recent years, only very, very few even mention the insurance value of the unemployment insurance scheme, but just focus on the efficiency effects. So the research, the policy advice which has been given has also sort of under-prioritized these issues, and that's perhaps one of the aspects which now backfire. The other thing is then related to your question, how can we build institutions, how can we have policies which deal with this, and that's of course the big question. And definitely one point from the Flexicurity discussion is that it's a package. It's the naive copy and paste thing that many people have looked at Denmark and said, oh, well, couldn't we just copy this? And then many think they should do the EPL part, and then they have it. And then, of course, it's the entire package. And if you don't have the entire package, what do you have? And how do you get the entire package? It's related to this thing about the social partners and so on. It has evolved over time. The trust between the partners, the trust in the public sector and the institutions is very important. Just one example, when we talk about these things in the Nordic countries, you should also understand we have a lot of checks and balances. So people have a great degree of trust in the public sector. Nobody, even on the right wing, would say discussing taxes would say something like feeding the beast or something like that. There's an understanding that taxes are used fairly in a fairly okay way, but we also have a lot of checks on that, a lot of controls, even at the individual level. So there's also a big broader aspect to that. And among academics, it's well known that the best individual data you find for the Nordic countries. But that's because we control so many things, and therefore we have this on the individual. So these things have been built up over a very long period of time. It's a package, and it's just not a naive copy and paste thing. So to start some of these things would have to be very country-specific, depending on the history and the institutions already in place. So I think it would be wrong to say, here's just one trick which would do it, because that's not the lesson you can draw from the Nordic countries. It's really a very complicated historical process. Yeah, thank you.
Thanks to both of you. Actually, I was really very, I found it extremely interesting. Thank you to the interpreters for staying a little longer. Thank you to all of you for also staying and listening to this discussion. Well, there will be another, the next of our lectures will be, if I'm not mistaken, on the 12th. On the 12th of December, I invite all of you to come and to invite others to come. So thank you, and see you in December.